Hi guys, welcome back to Chemistry is Easy for You. Today we are going to discuss a few MSc Chemistry entrance practice questions for Pune University exam. And the concepts and the questions that we are going to discuss today are not just important for this one exam, but is common for all exams including NEET and JEE. So I have chosen the questions in such a way that it will be helpful for each one of you preparing for every entrance examination. So let's begin. The first question here is, the state of hybridization of oxygen in OF2 is? So the first option is sp, second is sp2, third is sp3, and fourth is dsp2. As I have previously said, we have already discussed certain shortcut methods to find the hybridization of given molecule. So let's take a look at it. First of all, the answer here is sp3, and let's see how we have found this answer. So, for this, we have previously learned an equation, which is H is equal to half into V plus M minus C plus A, where V is the valence of the central metal atom, M is the number of monovalent atoms, and C is the charge of the cation, and A is the charge of the anion. So, in this case, our central atom is oxygen, and our monovalent atom is fluorine. So, half into 6 plus 2, 6 which is the valence of oxygen, and number of monovalent atoms is 2, which is fluorine. Then this does not have any cationic or anionic charge. So, 0, C and A both are 0. So, half into 6 plus 2, which is equal to 8 by 2, which is equal to 4. So, according to our previous video, we know that when H is equal to 4, our hybridization would be sp3. So, for those who have not watched that video yet, I'll give the link of that video in the description box below. Please watch that. It is going to be very helpful for you. So this type of question is very important, because one such question is sure. Like, this is a sure shot question for every examination. Hybridization and shape of the molecule is a sure question for every entrance examination. So you should be really thorough with this concept so that you could easily get 2 to 4 marks. If it is in CSA and NET, you can even expect a 4-mark question from this part. So 2 to 4 marks question can be easily guaranteed by just studying this part, and you can also just view all the shortcut methods we have described for this portion. I'll give all the links in the description box. Please do watch those. Now here the second question is, if the frequency of vibration in H2, that is the hydrogen molecule, is 4400 per centimeter, what is the frequency of vibration of HD? That is, instead of hydrogen, will this replaced by one deuterium, considering both has the same force constant? So all these values are given in per centimeter. So we need to find what would be the value of HD from the value of H2. So let's see. So previously in our spectroscopy first lecture, I have mentioned few equations, like the wave number is given as 1 by 2 pi c root of k by mu, where mu is the reduced mass, k is the force constant, and these values are all constant. And this is mu, not w, this is mu, mu bar. So what we could understand from this is, if all these values are constant, the frequency purely depends upon the reduced mass. Since this is constant, it will be common for both H2 and HD. And this they have given in the question that the value of K is also the same for both these molecules. So the whole value of the vibrational frequency depends upon the reduced mass, which is given by M1, M2 by M1 plus M2. Now let's use this particular relationship and this concept to find the frequency of vibration of HD from H2. So the answer would be 3740. Let's see how we get it. First of all, from those values, we can give the ratio as mu1 by mu2 will be equal to square root of mu2 by mu1. How? See, let's see here once again. It is inversely proportional. The frequency is inversely proportional to the reduced mass. So therefore, mu1 by mu2 will be equal to root of mu2 by mu1. Further, we can write mu1 as 1/2 and mu2 as 2/3. How? Because hydrogen has the value of mass as 1. So 1 × 1/1 + 1. That is the mass of reduced mass of H2. That is 1 × 1 + 1 + 1, which is 1/2. Similarly, 1 × 2/1 + 2 is the value for HD. So it is 2/3. Therefore, if we consider the frequency of HD as X, so vibrational frequency of HD as X, then what we can have? We have 4400 divided by X is equal to √2 × 2 / √2 √3 × 1. This is whole under root. So this value will be equal to X. So from this we can find the value of X as 4400 × 1.73 / 2. So 1.73 is the square root of 3, and square root of 2 × 2 is equal to 2. So this approximately equal to 3800. So the closest value given in the option will be is 3740. So that would be our answer. Okay. So this is how we will be finding. If the force constant is the same, and then the vibration frequency will be purely dependent upon the reduced mass. So we will be equate those, find the ratios, and then we'll try. So once again, let's see what is the concept here. So the wave number is equal to 1/2 πc k/μ, where k is the force constant. So in this question, they have given that the force constant for both these molecules is the same. So the wave number depends upon only the reduced mass, and the reduced mass is given by m1 m2 by m1 plus m2. So further we will be writing mu1 and mu2 as √(mu2/mu1), since it is inversely proportional to the square root of reduced masses. And we have found the reduced mass of h2 as 1/2 and hd as 2/3, and now equating the vibrational frequency of hd as x, we can write the whole thing as 4400, which is the given value, divided by x equal to √(mu2/mu1), which is given here, and from that we'll be getting the value of 3800. Okay. Now, also please do watch this spectroscopy lecture videos. I'll be putting the link in the description box below. Please do watch that one as well. Now to the third question. The number of vibration and rotational freedom for BF3 molecule respectively are. So the answer is 6 and 3. So here BF3 is a non-linear molecule. So for non-linear molecule, the number of vibrational degree of freedom is given by 3n − 6, where n is the number of atoms. So here there are 4 atoms, 3F and 1B. So 4 atoms. So 3 × 4 = 12 − 6 = 6 vibrational degrees of freedom. So there is only one option with 6 vibrational degrees of freedom. So option A itself would be our answer. So for a non-linear molecule, the number of vibrational degrees of freedom will be 3n − 6. Let's take this a little further. Please note this one down. This will be helpful for you. So if we have n atoms in a molecule, the total degree of freedoms become 3n. So each of the molecule has, because each atom has 3 degree of freedom. Now for a nonlinear molecule, what happens is every rotational motion of that will be described in terms of rotation around 3 axes. And therefore, for a nonlinear molecule, the rotational degree of freedom becomes 3. So what happens for a nonlinear molecule, every rotation will be around 3 axes, and therefore their rotational degree of freedom will be 3. And further, now the remaining will be constitutes the vibrational motion, which is 3n − 6. Now let's take the case of a linear molecule. So what happens in a linear molecule? The linear molecule will be having one axis of its own, and on rotating on that axis, it will not make any change to the molecule. So one rotational degree of freedom will be decreased, and therefore for linear molecule, there will be only 2 rotational degrees of freedom. So again, rotation on its own axis is not a rotation, because the molecule will not have any changes, and therefore there will be only 2 rotational degrees of freedom for a linear molecule, and the remaining 3n − 5 degrees of freedom will be there for vibration. So that's all about the degrees of freedom in molecules for nonlinear and linear. Please write this down. It will be helpful for you. Next, the polymers that cannot be recycled are called. This is very easy. It's the thermosets. Thermosetting plastics actually cannot be recycled. Let's take a look at the definitions of all these. So the thermosets are the plastics that cannot be recycled. So what happens is this will be melting and we cannot use this. I mean, once this is set, we cannot melt it back to the reusable form. So this cannot be recycled. Now, thermoplastic is the plastic polymer which becomes soft, but it can be heated and cooled several times. That is, it can be reused multiple times, and there will be no change in the chemical or mechanical property of a thermoplastic. Now, elastomer is a natural or synthetic polymer having elastic properties, and the example is well-known example is rubber. And further, now resins are type of viscous substances that convert into rigid polymers through curing process. And we'll be taking all these process in one of the coming videos. Then resins are naturally occurring, but also made synthetically. Okay. So thermosets are the ones which cannot be reused plastics. Okay. Now the fifth question, tetraalkyl ammonium bromide can be classified as. So it is one type of surfactant, and we need to find whether it is a cationic surfactant, anionic surfactant, non-ionic surfactant, or polymers. So what happens? It is a cationic surfactant, and you need to just memorize one thing to come to this conclusion, that quaternary ammonium compounds also can be written as QAC. These are all cationic surfactants, and tetraalkyl ammonium bromide is one such compound, which is a quaternary ammonium compound. So please remember, quaternary ammonium compounds are cationic surfactants. Now the sixth question. AgCl is not precipitated when AgNO3 is added to which of the following? So the first one is CONH3 4 times Cl2, and in outside the bracket we have Cl. Similarly, we have three different options. So it is very clear that it will be option D, that is CONH3 thrice Cl3. Why? Because all these are examples of a coordination complex. So in a coordination complex, there will be two different types of valences, which are primary valence and the secondary valence. And we know that secondary valences are non-ionizable. So outside this square bracket, whatever we have, they are the primary valence, and these can be ionizable. Like in the first three options, the outside the bracket, we have 1, 2, and 3 chlorine each, and these are ionizable since they are the primary valences. But inside the coordination sphere, which is inside this square bracket, these are the secondary valences and these are non-ionizable. And further, you need to understand that the secondary valences are equal to the coordination number of the central metal atom. Okay. So here the Cl3 inside the square bracket is non-ionizable, and therefore AgCl cannot be precipitated when AgNO3 is added to the fourth complex. So that's all. Now towards the seventh question. The synthetic transformation of CO to CH2 can be achieved by, we have Clemmensen reduction, Wolff-Kishner reduction, both A and B, neither A and B. So the answer is both A and B. So one thing you have to understand here is they have just given the functional groups, that is carbonyl to alkane. Only the functional group is given. If they have given some reagent, you should be very careful. Since they have given only the functional group, it is possible by both Clemmensen reduction as well as Wolff-Kishner reduction. So that is one thing. Now let's take a look at what Clemmensen reduction and Wolff-Kishner reduction are. First of all, Clemmensen reduction is the reduction of ketones or aldehydes to alkenes. And what you have to remember here, we use zinc amalgam and concentrated hydrochloric acid. So a representative example of this reaction is R1CoR2. So what happens? This represents the zinc amalgam and concentrated HCl. This O will be replaced by 2 hydrogen. So CO changes to CH2. That happens in Clemmensen reduction. So we have zinc amalgam and concentrated hydrochloric acid in Clemmensen reduction. Further, we have Wolff-Kishner reduction. So here what happens is it reacts with hydrazine, then form a hydrazone, and this hydrazone with the base induced reduction will form the corresponding alkene. So nitrogen will be removed and then we'll be getting a corresponding alkene. So this is the representative reaction. We'll be having a hydrazone formation and further which will be forming an alkane. So both these cases, the starting compound is a carbonyl compound and the end product is an alkane. So if the reagents were given, like in this question, if it was asked like what method gives you CO to CH2 conversion in the presence of zinc amalgam and hydrochloric acid, then your answer should be Clemmensen reduction. Or if hydrazine is given, your answer should be Wolff-Kishner reduction. But irrespective of the reagent, since they have asked only the functional group conversion, we should give the answer of both these reductions. Okay. Now towards the 8th question. This is a very simple question. The repeating unit of glycogen is. So glycogen basically is a polysaccharide, and previously in the memory hacks we have discussed all these things. Please do watch that memory hacks video as well. We'll be giving the link in the description box below. Watch that, it will be helpful for you. So here the answer is glucose, and glycogen is a multi-branched polysaccharide of glucose. So you know monosaccharides together forms a polysaccharide, and glycogen is one such polysaccharide with multiple branches. Now the 9th question, a gene is expressed as vitamin, protein, carbohydrate and fatty acid. This is very simple question, genetics, and gene can be expressed as a protein and not fatty acid, carbohydrate or vitamin, but it is expressed as proteins in our body. Now the 10th question, this question seems very simple, but you have multiple points to remember in this part. Which of the following does not exist? So we have 5 pentahalides given here, and we need to find out which one does not exist. The answer is pretty straightforward. The answer is NF5. NF5 does not exist. Why? So formation of pentahalides require sp3d hybridization. This is important. So for pentahalides, sp3d hybridization of central atom is required, and we know that for the sp3d hybridization, what we need an empty d orbital in the excited state, and nitrogen has no d orbital, and therefore it cannot form pentahalides. So that is the reason. So to form pentahalides or the halides with five halogens, there need to be a hybridization of sp3d, which requires empty d orbitals, and nitrogen does not have empty d orbitals, and therefore it cannot form nf5. And further, this point also you could remember that due to inert pair effect down the group, the stability of pentahalides decreases. So the pentahalide stability, PF5 will be greater than SBF5, greater than ASF5, greater than bismuth. So bismuth will be having the least stable pentahalide out of PSB and ASNBI. And in the halogens, fluorine will be having more stability, that pentafluorides will be having more stability than pentafluorides, than pentabromides. Okay. So why this happens? Because as the size of the halide increases, the steric hindrance decreases and the molecule becomes unstable. So what happens? Down the group, the pentahalide stability decreases, and also the smallest halide will be giving the most stable pentahalide. So these are the 10 questions that we have discussed today. These are practice questions for Pune University MSc Chemistry entrance exam, but this is important for all exams, because as you can see, we have discussed the important concepts from different portions which can be asked for every entrance examination. Please do note down all the important points. Watch all the lecture videos that we have discussed previously, and continue watching our channel. Please like this video, share it with all your friends. If you have not subscribed our channel yet, please subscribe our channel and hit the bell icon for latest notification. Understand that you people are really good. You just need some practice, and all of you can crack whatever entrance examination you want to. Keep preparing, and for any for your assistance, we are always here. Ask any doubts you have in the comment section below. Thank you so much. Have a good day, everyone.